Welcome back to Ucypher and Airsport, Nai Superstars. As we all know, the Akramaks have claimed the last spot in the semis. But the game is not over until it's over. It's time for Dota 2.
Ban.
Dire's ban now.
It's a bittersweet moment here for the Yodhas as they take on Akramaks at what is most likely their final game of Ucypher Season 1. Yodhas, they haven't had the best day today, but they do have a shot at cementing their lead on the Dota 2 circuit at the very least. I'm CloudX, with me is Vivek, and we're watching what's possibly Yodhas' last game on the main stage. Yodhas opening up with the Visage, Doom and Tidehunter bans, while Akramaks will go with the Venno, Lich and the Earthshaker. Vivek, you and I have talked about Yodhas having possibly the best Dota squad on this circuit.
Yeah.
How do you feel about them no longer being in the running for the top spots?
It hurts, man. I mean, the numbers are lying. This is one of those instances where the numbers don't make sense. The Yodhas is not going to progress further as far as Dota is concerned. But in my mind, and for me personally, they are the best team over here. And it just kind of sucks that they're not going to be playing any further on in this tournament, but they're still playing for pride. Rishabh has done a phenomenal job with the team. We were having this conversation, if there was an MVP for a captain, it has to be Rishabh. And if there's an MVP for a team that showed us how to play Dota and how Dota is meant to be played, it's the Yodhas.
Yeah, I agree. Yodhas have shown a certain level of maturity in this tournament. They've shown that Rishabh can lead from the front lines. And, you know, I think you've seen a lot of hatred. You've seen a lot of screaming and shouting across the stage. But Yodhas is one of those that's almost liked by everyone else that they compete against. It's probably the most civil team on this circuit so far.
I mean, if they were there, they'd definitely be a threat to the Yakshas. I can say that for sure. It would have been a close contest. The last time they played, I think Yodhas won. Punk tried his bit shouting and trying to tilt them, but 11, calm and composed.
It's hard to tilt your best friend outside the game as well, right? So he's probably not going to take it seriously, no matter how loud Punk shouts. But Yodhas are still fighting for this one. I did have a chat with Rishabh earlier on, and he said they're going to take this game with the utmost seriousness.
Okay.
Like the true sportsmen that they are. Shadow Demon and Mirana are going to be their opening picks. This is something that they have liked to run quite often. There's also two heroes with a fair bit of synergy among them. The disruption for the arrow setup is something that well-coordinated teams do excel at running. But Akramaks are no pushovers this time around. While they haven't had the best time throughout this Dota circuit, they're going to open with the Disruptor and the Clockwork, two of the more tried and tested stable ways to approach the early draft phase, the 4 and the 5 position being picked up here.
So Akramaks have been switching things up. The one time it worked for them was when Kiko and Blue Frog were the two supports. The last time they played, it was make-believe leading the draft. This time it's Kiko. I hope Kiko is also going to be playing the support role, because that's when things really work for the Akramaks. Mm-hmm. When it was Kiko and Blue Frog on the two supports, when they popped that level 1 smoke and actually got a kill, with so many teams that tried to replicate but failed so far. If I'm not mistaken, the Akramaks, irrespective of the result of this game, will be up against the Yakshas.
But, you know,
this game is still...
More than the standings, I think this game is about sending a message by the Akramaks. If they can find their stride and their groove this late into the tournament, going into the semi-finals, if they turn out to be the dark horse, I mean, as of now, let's be honest, teams are not taking Akramaks' Dota squad very seriously. They're basically considering it as a win for the most part. But therein lies their advantage. The element of surprise is with the Akramaks. And we honestly believe that they are good players. They're a bunch of skilled players that have been put under one roof. Unfortunately, that roof doesn't have an in-house mama. There's no real in-game leader for their team. Akramaks have just been doing their own thing for the most part.
And, they did have it in that one game where Kiko was playing the support position. I think they need to stick to that. That's what's worked for them. A lot of teams go back and look at replays in which they end up losing. EG is one of those teams that looks at replays where they win. And a lot of Counter-Strike teams do this as well. I hope the Akramaks go back and look at what makes them work. And for me, it's Kiko and Blue Frog on the support role. That game was Blue Frog and the Earthshaker. If I'm not mistaken, I'm not entirely sure. Kiko was playing the Ogre. Hold on, Blue Frog was on the Vengeful Spirit. Yeah, and it really worked for them. Then they tried to switch things up. Kiko went on to the core position, and that really didn't end up working for them. Back to the draft, Yodhas have picked up the Spectre. It's
So what's worrisome for Akramaks right now is that Yodhas have a Spectre and a Shadow Demon duo, and Akramaks don't really have a way to deal with illusions. They've picked up their two supports. None of them are good at taking down illusions. Spectre, fantastic versus the Disruptor as well, because of the way dispersion works. If you stand in the Static Storm AoE, you're guaranteed dispersion damage on anyone that comes next to you. Terrorblade, he's a massive source of physical damage, and in this particular game, I think he needs to be the Silver Edge carrier as well on the side of Akramaks.
Okay.
It's not unheard of to see Terrorblades going for the Dragon Lance and then going back for a possible Silver Edge. Even if it comes towards the later stages of the game, it's absolutely necessary that they have Break versus that Spectre. Legion Commander is going to be the pick for the Yodhas. There's a bit of... There's kind of a lack of synergy between the Shadow Demon and the Legion Commander. On one hand, sure, you do manage to get the setup to run in and get that duel off. But on the other hand, there's always the chance that you're going to get a bad disruption off in the middle of a duel. It happens on occasion. It's something that's very likely to happen here as well if they're not on the same page.
Yeah.
There's also the fact that there seems to be a lack of burst damage on the side of Yodhas. And that's something you want to have going into a matchup with the Legion Commander. I'd love to see an Invoker pick coming out from the Yodhas as their final pick, but it's unlikely because I'm thinking this is going to be a mid-Mirana.
10 seconds.
You know, one way to switch gears is to run this as a four-position Mirana,
When they opened with the Shadow Demon Mirana, I was actually thinking to myself that this could be a four-position Mirana. Last ban for the Yodhas. Anything that secures their mid lane without giving away too much. So you spoke of the Invoker. On the basis that this is a four position Mirana, I like the Invoker, I like the Queen of Pain as well. What else do they have?
For the Akramaks, I'm thinking the Queen of Pain makes a fair bit of sense. You'll have some burst damage to deal with the Legion Commander himself, and you'll have that ganking potential early on as well. But they have a few options here. I mean, up until the Radiance comes online, there isn't too much damage over time, so a Templar makes sense in that department. If you want to just augment your push, you get the Dragon Knight. That bonus armor is not too bad versus the Legion Commander either. However, Shadow Demon will have a field day by pulling out those Elder Dragon form Dragon Knight illusions. The Co-op will be banned out. Yodhas are going to take away a fair bit of mobility away from the Akramaks with that ban. But if Akramaks really want to go all in and commit to a push here, and not deal with that Spectre going into the late game stage, they could even go for the Puck. Puck's not the ideal pusher, but Puck is that source of control on the battlefield that you need when the Terrorblade is looking to pound away on targets with his absurd amounts of base attack time and, well, absurdly low base attack time and absurd amounts of base attack damage. My top picks for Akramaks, Puck, Dragon Knight, or... Yeah, I think it's just the Puck and the Dragon Knight, actually. Those are my top picks for them. Not too much of a fan of the Templar, but I wouldn't be entirely against it. Pugna's in the mix as well, and that could be a pushing pickup that could work out for them, actually.
5 seconds remaining.
How about Yodhas, though? They're looking for what we assume to be a four position or a mid.
So the Akramaks could do something. It's still not too greedy. They've done it in the past. They could just pick up the Arc Warden here, who's a strong laner. The magnetic field is great. You can still place it in such a way that the Legion Commander gets nothing done in the duel. The split push could be healthy. It means that Spectre might, well, have to deal with the split push coming out from the Tempest double and then have to haunt into battle.
The problem with that is that Spectre is actually good versus the Arc Warden.
Yeah.
You want to be able to get up close and personal. The haunt gets you a free ticket right next to him. I'd be worried if I was Akramaks and if they had Arc Warden on their minds here. I don't think that's the way to go. I mean, think about it. You've got the Legion and the Spectre that like to get right next to a hero to dish out their damage. And Arc Warden is literally the prime candidate for that. Even a Shadow Demon and a Mirana running around the map by themselves can make quick work of the Arc Warden in this game. Yodhas have something to deal with the illusions now with the Legion Commander. The overwhelming odds will work.
What do you think about Wiper? Okay. This is a combo.
Yeah, I'm not convinced at all by this Windranger pick.
Seconds.
I don't think she's been buffed enough to be considered as a viable middle lane hero. And in this game, I honestly don't see too much reason to pick up the Windranger. Sure, you've got that extra disable with the Shackle Shot. Now you've got a Sand King, Burrow Strike, and a Shackle Shot to lock down a target. But versus the Spectre, I don't know. I feel like the Windranger is not going to do too well.
Okay, and it's an Acne Pudge once more. He's going to the mid lane on that Mirana.
We have seen Acme just devastate his opponents on that Pudge in the past, and it's been working for them. It's also a pick that can give them a lot of early game momentum and space creation, which will allow Shondi to get his farm rolling. Yodhas have a good draft. I want to say that I favor the Yodhas draft here. Akramaks have, their only opportunity is in their push. If they can survive the early game, if they can get a good start going with the Terrorblade, getting some early farm and maybe a quick tier 1 tower, they could snowball out of control to the point where Shondi gets restricted to farming inside of his own base when the creeps come up his slope. The problem is that requires an immense amount of high-level decision-making and coordination, which, frankly, I don't think the Akramaks have.
I mean, they've shown it on one occasion in the past. Let's see if they can recreate the success that they had the one time around. For now, it is Kiko playing the Terrorblade and make believe going to the mid lane while Max is playing the Disruptor. Are they going to switch things up?
No, Max is going to be running the Disruptor for them. So
okay,
Kiko's
so Max played the offlane for them in the past. The Akramaks making another change. And let's hope it works out for them.
Yeah, well, Kiko has played the one position early in this tournament, if I'm not wrong. Either he played the one or the mid. But I think he's a little more confident leading from the front lines. They also know, I mean, they know that they're in through to the semi-finals regardless. So, I mean, maybe they're just experimenting. It's got to be a comfortable situation to be in if you're on the Akramaks squad, right? You know for a fact that you're through, so you can play with a little less pressure on your heads. I'm wondering what the sentiment is like in the Yodhas camp. I mean, I'd love to know whether they're a little demoralized because of the way their CS team performed today, or if they're going to be completely motivated to take the gold in Dota at least.
It hurts. I mean, like, Ucypher is a team game at a whole new level. Your single player's got to do well. Your Counter-Strike has got to do well, and your Dota has got to do well. If one of them slip up or they've been through a rough patch, no matter how good your Dota side is, you're not going to get through to the qualifiers or to the knockout stage of the tournament. CS was quite close as well.
The great Indian Dota pause is upon us once again.
It's usually Mama Sita that's the root cause of this. I bet he's at home and he's asked for a pause from there.
What are your thoughts? I mean, quick predictions. If we had any money and if we were betting men, who would you put your money on?
I'm going to put my money... See, look, I'm going to put my money on the Akramaks for this one. I think they've done one small significant thing that might be enough for them to win the game. I think they're going to run an aggressive try. And that might be just
you
enough.
You realize you're then putting your money on a statement that basically says,
oh, no, wait, hold on.
We'll learn how to end the game quickly. Because they can't take this late.
Yeah, they're thinking of, they're hoping to run the, I mean, end the game quickly. They're doing what they did last time around. Teams have wisened up to this. I mean, the last time this happened, actually.
Did you just see what happened? That Blue Frog walked into the tower range while walking into the jungle under cover of a smoke, and his smoke broke.
Okay. Shondi's just hugging his tier 1 tower. By this point, both teams know what's up.
I legitimately don't understand why they keep doing this.
So how do they hope to get this started? What's the plan here? Level 1 Bow Strike, level 1 Shackle Shot. What? Okay, so they cut this down while they made that excursion. And
I actually think this is one of those games where 11 and the boys could have contested at level 1.
Yeah?
Overwhelming odds with multiple heroes. Shadow Demon, if he put the point into Shadow Poison, he's actually got disruption.
So they did go to contest, but this isn't really a contest.
Oh,
this,
what I mean is contesting now means taking your own route.
Yeah, contesting
that's what
now
you
means taking
contest
your own
means.
Route. Or using this opportunity to try and set up in the mid lane. Which is what happened earlier on between the Sherdils and the Yakshas. The Sherdils, they went to the enemy rune and they set up for a kill in the mid lane. And it seems as a Blue Frog as well as 11 are doing pretty much just that. You got the disruption, Apps is not even bothering with the arrow.
Yeah, he didn't have the line for it. Make Believe will be forced to pop one of those wind runs and apps. He'll be able to push out the wave a bit here. Blue Frog's coming.
Just running down 11 here. The arrow comes out. Blue Frog doesn't bother to move. This could be first blood. I think Blue Frog's done for, but Acme with the rod still has enough damage.
Oh no.
So 11 gets first blood. Make Believe puts the first skill point into wind run. Huh.
He's actually used two wind runs by now. The first one was when Shadow Demon came running at him, but it's 1-0 now in favor of Yodhas, and
look,
they're off to a good start.
Kiko level 1 Metamorphosis, just asserting dominance and pushing Shondi away from the lane. First blood on a Clockwork, I guess it's something the Akramaks can accept. It's not ideal. It's especially not ideal when Blue Frog had this ward in the mid lane, and he actually saw Acme TP in.
So 11's sacrifice has actually been rewarded now. He's walking about with one Tango and a TP scroll. He pretty much bought everything for his team and he got rewarded with first blood. That's mm-hmm. the ideal way for Yodhas to open this game up.
Yeah.
It's going to mean that 11's going to have his boots online and might even be able to call out another early smoke. They don't need one though. Acme is holding on to smoke. Shondi, unfortunately, has been left to his own devices here. And he's got no CS whatsoever. Kiko and Max are just bullying him.
I'm not exactly a fan of the ward that the Akramaks have planted. It gives vision behind the tower, but it doesn't give vision towards the side of the lane, which is where the party likes to hang out. And actually, just by being there, there's the threat of the hook that's going to come into play. Disruption coming up from 11. Acme is going to walk in with the rod, but there's a lot of damage he's taken. And Kiko might just go to return kill. It's Blue Frog who gets revenge with the battery assault. He's moving in for a second, but this is a tall order. Max needs to be careful because Acme's respawned and yeah, they're just going to back up.
I'm not entirely sure what happened there, but it looked like the reflection just destroyed the Pudge.
Yeah. So Pudge doesn't have that much HP at level 1. If everybody just turns and hits a Pudge or walks in with Rod, three heroes are definitely going to hurt more than a Pudge.
Yeah, I mean, to put things in perspective, he's at 700 HP with 1 armor at level 1, while the Clockwork's at 720 HP with 2 armor.
Yeah.
And Pudge is supposed to be the tank hero. It's also the fact that he hits himself with the Rod.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, this
bottom
lane, there it is.
Acme, perfect. He's caught, Max. You got the reflection. Shondi's caught in the kinetic field, but Kiko without the metamorphosis can't really find the kill. Blue Frog running away with the battery assault. He's hit level 2, but that's about it.
So the Soul Catcher did connect. That was just illusion, Soul Catcher and a few auto attacks that brought Blue Frog down a bit low, but Acme redeems himself after walking in carelessly from the backside the first time around. He gets a solid hook off and gets a kill on the bottom lane.
Mm-hmm.
The kill does go over to Acme himself, he'll be happy about that. But Shondi's gonna need a bit more backup in this lane, man, because they're doing what they can to shut down this Spectre and it's working for now. I also don't think that hook would have got them much joy, because Kiko had the Metamorphosis and 5 Wand charges. They could have simply turned and got a return kill themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Shondi needs to tango up immediately.
Yeah, Shondi, he's...
middle lane. Apps could be sniped in the next 4 seconds, but he has the salve.
Bottom lane seems like they're going in again. Shondi, hooked to safety by Acme. The last auto attack, dodged by the smoke, if I'm not mistaken. And Kiko pops the Metamorphosis. So they're just going to wait for a bit and go once more.
Defensive smoke popped. Acme's out of mana. Shondi's out of HP and has to go back to base. This aggressive tri lane has worked wonders for Akramaks.
Yeah, that was the basis of my bet. I mean, you're giving the Sand King a decent lane. Windranger versus Mirana. I want to say the Windranger's going to do okay. And if they just play this tri lane right, the aggressive tri lane, they're doing pretty good for themselves.
Sand King is actually decimating Kira. He's at 24-2, 25-2 while Kale's at 17-0 and has to make his way back into the lane.
Once he picks up Infused Raindrops, and I actually like the Arcane Boot pickup, he can pretty much push the Legion Command out of lane. A couple of caustic hits, go in with the Burrow Strike. He can actually spam Burrow Strike.
Bottom
lane, it seems as if they found a kill on 11. 2-2 is the score.
They found a kill on 11, and I think Shondi had to TP back to the base after he literally just came back there.
Ah, okay. I seem to have missed that. 11 is TPing back. Needs to be careful. Now, Max doesn't have mana for the glimpse. but they have got to Deep and Acme coming in, looking for the hook. Needs Sean need to do that damage. The disruption is there. 11 needs to move. The hook, well, it's not going to connect. The illusions will block the path for the Pudge. Acme going though. He's caught Blue Frog, who's popped the battery as well, and there's nothing that can save him here. Two stacks of Shadow Poison. 11 activates it and secures the kill.
Acme single-handedly keeping his team in this on this bottom lane.
Yeah. What's the point of this ward if you're not making use of it? I don't understand. You've got tri-lanes are...
They did use the ward.
They did use the ward, but there are about a couple of key things, right? Your cooldowns and your vision. That's what you got to work around in the tri-lane.
You know, I don't think Kale should be losing this lane that badly.
But it's once the Sanctum picks up infused raindrops, it gets harder.
I mean, you can go trading hits with him. At the end of the day, press the attack should do a fair bit more damage than... Sorry. Moment of Courage should do a bit more damage than caustic stacks.
Yeah. Is there a way you would approach this lane differently in terms of skill build? Do you think press the attack and Moment of Courage overwhelming odds? Anything you would try to change to make this lane work in your favor if you're the NC?
Probably, yeah, maybe you'd consider going for a few more points in Moment of Courage, because you know that the Sand King is going to go for that
caustic
finale. But
anyway, Shandi tagged with the Thunder Strike. The kinetic feels perfect. The disruption is there. Shandi's lunch up the Spectral Dragon. He's been pushed back by the cogs. Kiko changes targets. He's wasting his Metamorphosis on Acme, but Blue Frog trying to run him down. They're hoping to get this kill. Blue Frog tanking too much from the tower. Acme with the hook brings down Blue Frog. They were punished for that deep dive, but 11 out of position.
Max is
four
dead.
Stacks of Shadow Poison on Max, and Max drops low. The overwhelming odds from Kale secures the kill, and the duel is there. The Sand King hasn't rotated, and they managed to find a kill on the Terrorblade. Beautifully done there by the Yodhas.
They basically destroyed that tri lane on the back of Legion Commander's level 6 rotation. This time around, it's really rare to see a Legion get a level 6 kill immediately, and that too on a position, one on the other side.
Yeah.
This is a fantastic start coming out from the Yodhas. They're leading the charge here. That offensive tri lane, it was working for the first 3 minutes, and then it's just gone downhill for the Akramaks.
You know, but it's going to peak again quite soon, because Dream is just making good progress towards his Blink Dagger on the Sand King. And the problem for the Yodhas is... the supports are pretty much just going to sit in this lane and babysit the Spectre. They really can't try and help out the Mirana in the mid lane. And I'm going to actually drop down the net where the Windrange is doing a fair bit better than the Mirana.
Yeah, Mirana is losing mid quite hard as well.
They're persistent with this aggressive tri lane, and it's paying dividends.
Apps chose to go for the Ring of Aquila as his first item and then followed with the Raindrop.
The hook will whiff. Kiko doesn't have the Metamorphosis. Sorry, I cut you off. What were you saying?
So I think this is a game where Apps should have considered ignoring the Infused Raindrops early on.
Most of the Wind Ranger?
Yeah, most of the Wind Ranger. He's relying on his mana pool to go down and farm the wave, but just by virtue of having more auto attack damage or better base attack time, or attack speed in that sense, I think he'd have done a lot better versus this Wind Ranger.
Mm-hmm.
Tread's Rush after the Ring of Aquila possibly would have been best. Maybe the Magic Wand for the extra stats. But in the overall scheme of things, I don't think these Infused Raindrops are going to add that much value.
Mm-hmm.
Bottom, Shandi's up to level 5. The Haunt's going to be online shortly. And that could be their cue to make a play. But Blue Frog and Max, they're going to go hunting themselves right now.
Yeah.
They have eyes on Mirana, but she's got 3 charges in the Leap and those Raindrops, as we pointed out earlier. This... could be the reason she has the Raindrops.
Tom, I don't know. They need a Shackle Shot. It's a level 2 Shackle Shot.
It's not enough.
This is ambitious. I mean, the better way to do this is to hold on to your aggressive drive. It was working. It was keeping 11 and Acme busy. They were trading a bit, but they were applying pressure on Shandi as well. Kiko gets hooked perfectly down by Acme, in between the creeps. Kiko trying to turn it around. He doesn't have the Sunder, but he's got a lot of HP. Shandi comes in, gets the kill, and Acme survives. The supports left the lane, and the Co paid the price. Now, Max is looking for the glimpse. He's got it up on 11.
The save.
I'm not sure it connected, but the hook was there, keeping 11 alive. And they do not find anything in exchange.
Top tier Pudge plays, man. I'm so impressed with Acme right now.
Yeah.
Just hanging in the back, waiting to bail his buddies out, finding the initiations. That too on the most crucial target in the lane. Can he be any more high impact here, honestly? I guess the saving grace for Akramaks is that Dream almost has his blink dagger.
Yeah.
The epi blink is going to be a reality now going forward into the next few fights. But Dream's going to go in on the Legion Commander. Legion could just turn on him. Chooses not to pop the duel just yet. Just gets a couple of hits off on Dream. And once again, Acme is fishing. I don't think he's going to find anyone this time around because Kiko's positioning very defensively right next to his creeps. They're also pinging out where Akramaks could be hanging about. But
they're going to try. They got the disruption into the soul catcher, but 11 has no control on where these illusions spawn. And that makes it harder for even a seasoned Poch player like Akramaks.
Meanwhile, Mirana's going for the rune, but Max is waiting with the invisibility picked up. Apps just immediately jumps back to the lane.
I think he spotted that out. Not sure.
He knew something was up because Make Believe was running parallel along with him, and he had that Radiant Observer Ward to watch Make Believe running down the river.
Yeah. Well, it's Dream's turn to shine on the side of the Akramaks. He's got an early blink. Can get a lot done across the map early on. Kiko has the Metamorphosis available, so if they do manage to find the killer on the back of Dream's blink dagger, they could easily convert this into a push. Akramaks is hanging in the side. I'm not sure how 11 sensed he was there. Possibly he walked past the dire sentry and I think that's it. 11 caught by the Thunderstrike is going to get glimpsed. The disruption not going to save him, and Kiko with the Metamorphosis should be able to get this kill, but what was that? They goofed up.
Okay, so Sand King did show himself on the map, so if they were looking
at 11 goes in. Two-man battle strike. Kiko needs to come in. Immediate Moonlight Shadow from the Mirana, hoping to keep them alive, but Kiko secures the kill. The hook is there. He's got Kiko. Kiko does have the Sunder. They've got to respect that. The Reflection doing some work. Apps is TP'd in. Starstorm, where's the Sunder? It's not there. Apps gets the kill. The Epicenter comes in. They're moving in for more. The duel onto the Disruptor. They bring him down as well. And Dream in that Sandstorm, hoping to stay alive. Won't be so lucky. Kale scores the double. Everybody moved to this bottom lane except the Windranger. Make Believe did have a TP on him though.
That's going to be the blink dagger now for the Legion Commander as well. And look at what just happened. He got a double kill, he got another duel victory, and he's on top of the net worth charts. Kale's the most farmed hero in this game, and it's all because he shows up at the right time to the right fights.
Yeah.
It's not because he's winning his lane convincingly. It's just good decision making coming about when to pick and choose his battles. With that blink dagger, everything that the Sand King worked for in the first 10 minutes has just been eroded, and Yodhas will continue their onslaught.
Mm-hmm. There's smoke, they're hanging around the mid lane, the Windranger moving towards the top lane. Something isn't really right. Akne gets glimpsed to the mid lane and Dream is seeping in, might get hooked, but there's a second too late. Goes in, two-man Bardo Strike. Akne with the Dismember onto the Sand King. The power shot sails through. Nobody falling just yet. Apps got in the kinetic field, holding onto his leap charges.
Look at Akne still fishing.
Looking
though.
For another hook.
They pinged him. They know he's hanging about there.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a ward literally right next to him.
But Kiko's going to apply some pressure on the top tier one. And Kale, with a Haunt, they could bring down the
Haunt's on cooldown though, 96 seconds. Dream's in trouble. I mean, Spectre's in trouble. Dream goes upon him.
Dream's going in. Didn't get the caustic from that creep, which was low.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, it was just Dream that came in. Akme, just looking to get in from behind, but can't quite get the job done. Dream blinks away. Kale still hanging about top. Remember, he has the overwhelming odds as well as a duel in 7 seconds. Kiko has to be careful about whether or not he wants to go for this. Mm-hmm. He actually chose not to put a single point into Conjure Image. He's going for maxed out Reflection.
Hmm. Now he's put a point.
Yeah, there we go. Kale is ready to go once again. Kiko is going to go to work on that tier 1, but he's not getting any backup here, Kale. Everyone on the side of Yodhas is just continuing to farm their own lanes, hoping to get something else done. It's a little surprising that they chose not to go for this, though. I mean, they can contest. It's just the Disruptor, the Clockwork, and Kiko.
Our Dream, mid lane, goes in. Make Believe lining up the Shackle. Not going to connect. The Power Shot doesn't connect either. Now here comes Kale.
No,
he glimpses into the mid lane, but gets glimpsed right back to the top, where Kiko's making quick work of this tier 1. Kane trying to run in for the duel. No, this is such a good idea.
I don't think he needs to duel. All he's got to do is go right-click the Terrorblade and
Meanwhile,
send it back.
Meanwhile, in the river, they manage to catch Acme. Acme will try and bring Max down with him, but the Sand King tanks the arrow and keeps the Disruptor alive. Here comes App, brings down the Sand King, while Shondi moves on to the Disruptor. They lose the Pudge, but
Meanwhile,
what they find...
Terrorblade is duking it out with a duel from the Legion Commander, and duel victory again secured for Kale. Across the map, it's just a disaster for Akramaks. They lose two in the middle lane, all for the price of a Pudge, and then they lose their Terrorblade on the top side, giving up another 10 bonus damage to the Legion Commander. That's a level 2 duel now online for her. And her Blade Mail is well on its way as well.
Dire's top tower needs some What's been wrong for the Akramaks? I'm really not too sure. I don't know. They tried to bring down
I want to say it started with the anti-snowball effect on the bottom lane, right?
Okay. Good rotation. That one rotation from Kane.
Yeah.
Where the Mirana rotated in as well. And
not just the one rotation, it's also a lot of Acme's shenanigans in the early stages of
yeah.
the game.
Acme
finds
doing
another
some more of it.
One.
Finds
though.
Kiko all by himself. The duel not available.
It's there.
It's there. They've caught the Terrorblade. They should be able to bring him down. Dream just runs away and Kale. He's racking up that dual victory damage.
Kale's having an amazing time here, man. 44 stolen damage this early on in the game. It's unheard of. It's ridiculous. That's literally a little more than a full Demon Edge purchase that 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Think of him as having a Blink Dagger, Phase Boots, Wand, and a Demon Edge, and he's almost got his Blade Mail online as well.
All of this, though, space for Shondi to farm. Everything seems to be going as per plan for the Yodhas.
I'm actually in favor of not rushing the Radiance for Shondi and going for the Diffusal Blade this game, or maybe even a Mantis style. If you can have multiple targets for the Terrorblade to focus his efforts on, Shondi should have the upper hand in those fights.
Acme, Moonlight Shadow, fishing. I think he saw Dream there, I'm not entirely sure.
Have the Blink and the Duel if they wanted to go for this.
They had a Dire Sentry, so I think Dream saw them, but didn't want to go in because his team wasn't nearby. Kiko, he's had enough of, trying to be aggressive early on and farmed up some cheap stats in the form of those drums and trying to move to what seems to be the safest lane on the map. But everywhere he goes, there's a Pudge awaiting him. Can Acme bring him down once more?
Kale is preemptively holding on to two TPs, by the way. He desperately wants to fight at every opportunity that his teammates are going to give him.
I mean, everybody's got a TP. On the side of the Yodhas. Shondi, 2,500 gold. 17 minutes in, he's still making decent timing towards the Radiance, but you spoke of more targets, providing him a better matchup versus the Terrorblade. I don't know, how does that work? Isn't the evasion from Radiance also good? Look at this.
No.
They've got the Disruptor. He drops the Static Storm. Sure, Pudge is caught in the kinetic field. Maybe Blue Frog can find a kill in response. They will finally punish the Pudge. It's a 4-for-5. And Blue Frog didn't TP in. And
I mean, in a 1-for-1 trade, the team that's behind usually comes out ahead. In this particular case, though, that's not so because Apps also takes a tier 1 tower in exchange. So the scales are once again tipped in favor of.
It's gonna get worse.
Yodhas.
Kale is coming in, overwhelming on. Blinks right next to Kiko, but misses with the duel. Dream was waiting patiently, but wasn't quick enough to jump in with the Barrow Strike. Now he could go in. They've got the Metamorphosis. They could
the
channel up
there,
the epicenter. But the Haunt was committed. It's canceling the Blink. Dream just walks in and gets dueled by Kale. Offlaner upon offlaner. And Kale comes out on top. Another
what
duel victory for him.
And Acme
with a hook. I saw it coming, but I assumed it wasn't going to connect, so I didn't even bother.
What a guy, man. What a guy. This guy is playing out of his mind today. No one gets away from the long arms of Acme this game. He's just constantly pulling them back every time they think they're secure. Windranger just took a straight path up the slope, hoping to get back under her tower. But one cheeky Radiant Observer Ward was all it took for him to get a glimpse of her running past this, post which he throws a hook. The confidence with which he's throwing them out, man, it's something else.
Where are these Pudge players in my matchmaking? Where do you find them? Please give me one of these Pudge players. Anyway, another hard hit for the Akramaks. Shawnee going unchecked.
You know,
the Windranger, the snowball, hasn't done too much.
She's done nothing, let's be honest. This Windranger pick has been an absolute flop so far. But the snowball effect is not just coming on the back of Kayle and the dual damage. Once the Pudge starts putting points into the flesh heap, those 9 assists and 4 kills are going to add to his tankiness as well.
Yeah.
I mean, the worst of Pac-Man is yet to come.
And Kayle now at the top of the net worth charts. These Legion commanders that don't build Iron Talon and go to the offlane like real men.
What
these
Iron
Pudges
Talon?
Who connect hooks. Where are they when I need them? Shandy moves to the top lane. He's got his relic picked up. Link Billy still farming away. He's got the mainstream. Haven't seen a single shackle shot resulting in a
Kale's
kill.
Kale's busy though.
A single kill. And Kale jumps in. What did I miss?
He got it! And Acme even pulls max again. Buy one, get one free offer is still going on here. Every time Kale jumps in, Acme pulls someone else and Acme's not
Acme's
done.
Acme's going in for more. This time there's a shackle shot. He turns around for the focus fire, but here comes Kale to the rescue. A little slow with the press the attack, but it wasn't cooldown. They're moving on for Blue Frog. The battery
epicenter,
is all behind
though.
That. There's the epicenter. They've got 11. The power shot could result in a kill on Shandy. Blue Frog falls to Kale, and Kale trying to turn this around, and indeed he can. With Mirana nearby, Mirana's gone on to Dream, while Kale jumps forward for the Windranger. It's domination from the offlane, and Dream just blinks into the trees and wants to run away home.
I mean, at this point, Kale has more than a free Sacred Relic as well. He's practically more farmed than the Spectre and does more damage than the Spectre on this battlefield. Just because he doesn't have the duel doesn't mean you can ignore him, man. That's what they learned the hard way on the side of Akramaks. Sure, they managed to bring down the Spectre and they delayed the Radiance a little bit, but the Tier 1 tower goes down. Yodhas still come out on top in that fight. And I mean, their onslaught is not stopping because Apps also picks up a Diffuser Blade. Now he sees Max in the jungle, but Max sees him as well. One leap
Apps
away.
Apps can get glimpsed back.
He should
Max.
Throw out the glimpse here, but he doesn't have backup.
Yeah.
Apps also probably wants to wait for his Diffuser Blade to fly out to him before he makes the next play. I think it's undisputed at this point that Acme is just stealing the show. His Aether Lens is nearly complete. Yeah, it's actually complete.
I mean,
complete
Acme
now.
Is the show.
He is the show, really. Chose to go for the plus 5 armor talent instead of 35 rot damage, so. His job is to land a hook and then stay back while his teammates will finish up on the rest. No Hood of Defiance coming out for Acme, so the plus 5 armor, I guess I can get behind it.
Moonlight Shadow. The Zai Observer did scout it out. And that's going to ensure that Mig Billy just runs back towards his tier 2.
Casual blind hook. Acme just fishing with every bone in his body right now, but this time it's not a very fruitful hook. Kale's queued up the BKB, so he's just looking to survive because damage is no longer a problem for him.
Lane, Max, Dream, Mig Billy. Trying to find a kill. The Shackle will miss, the Glimpse is there. It's 11. Heavy commitment for the Shadow Demon, but Shandy is the one who they actually end up catching. Blue Frog secures the kill, and 11 can't do much to keep his one position alive.
It doesn't matter though. Shandy's finished up the Radiance. He didn't have
Acme,
it on him.
Acme, Max, who's he gonna catch? This time he's gonna miss. But Apps with the Diffusal Blade should get the kill, and indeed he does. Here comes the Epicenter. They managed to bring down 11, but an immediate duel from Kale will ensure the death upon the Sand King. Kale can just run right in. The hook is there upon to make believe. They pulled him where he didn't want to be. It's a monster kill streak for Kale. Rishabh having the time of his life there.
Acme is just, time and time again, when you think you've managed to escape, Acme just pulls you right back into his loving belly. Kiko did get a tier 1 tower on the bottom lane on the back of that, but it's a consolation prize at this point. Yasha, drums, treads, it means nothing because he can't join the fight. Kale just throws overwhelming odds on him. And guess what? They have Haunt and they have Radiance if Shandy really wants to commit to another fight.
In his backpack. I think if 11 throws out the Shadow Poison, no, yes.
It's too quick actually, you don't want to go chasing a terrible attack far out.
And Blue Frog's even TP'd back to Shrine, but they do manage to get a tier 2 tower. Now they're moving towards the tablet. Illusion on the floor, Apps doesn't have any more charges at the lead.
Haunt's been thrown down.
Dream's TP'd in as well, the hook will miss from Acme, but Kale has the duel.
They've gone in on Kiko, by the way, on the side. Shandy just committed and now Kale comes in. He smacks him with the 1-2 punch and takes him out. Paper is what they're calling him now on stage.
Sorry, if it seems that the moment I go silent, it's just because we're admiring the banter on stage. Anyway, Shandy, Kale, and 11 just pushing down the tier 2. Acme fishing for the hook.
I mean, at this point, they're even taking pot shots at the marksman in the dugout.
Yeah, that's what that sounded like.
What better way to bond than to diss one of your mutual enemies, right?
Yeah.
The enemy of my enemy is my friend, and apparently they both have a mutual enemy here. But anyway, back to the game. 26-11.
10,000 net worth. Desperate times are for the Akramaks, and they're going to smoke and hope to find something in response. Now, Blue Frog could get this started with a good hook. Two-man Bow Strike, indoor Static Storm should be a couple of kills if Kiko is there to clean up with the Metamorphosis. They need to make that happen. And the only time they can do this is when Shondi's Haunt is on cooldown. If there ever was a chance for the Akramaks to try and find their way back into this game, it's now.
Is it though? Because Kale's finished a full BKB as well.
Okay. So there is no way back into the game for them.
What's going on here? I mean, how on earth did Kale get so fat so fast?
Kale has more net worth than his mid laner. Kale has more net worth than his one position. Kale has more net worth than anyone on this map.
I want to say a lot of that is attributed to Acme as well. I mean, the only reason Kale gets into the successful early game fights is because Acme manages to pull them out of position.
Every time post game, somebody comes and asks us, who do you think is the MVP? We don't have to wait post game. It's Acme.
No, I mean, Kale, he's up there as well, right? Okay. Kale and Acme is probably the contest here.
Acme, Hook, Kiko. It's almost as if he heard us and he wants to prove his point. The duel is there upon the Terrorblade. They've bought down the primary source of damage. Dream comes in with the Epicenter. The Static Storm. Both connect on no one. And Kale is just running them down. Two hits means that the Disruptor is dead.
What
he
is this?
He pops his BKB. Blue Frog dead in three hits.
What is this, man? He's got 126 damage 26 minutes in. This doesn't even happen in like a pub game where you get matched with people outside of your MMR bracket. Kale is absolutely slaughtering them at this point. And it all started because of Acme once again.
Yeah.
Double damage.
Acme once again with that neat little hook onto the Terrorblade. To ensure that they get the kill upon him.
Sure, pick up a DD rune, will you? Not like you have... I mean, he's got too little damage. He needs the DD, of course.
Yeah.
E0 Shun for Yodhas. They have a 14,000 net worth lead. They may be out of the tournament, but they're not letting Dota go easily.
I also want to say that, I mean, if there's one thing that the Akramaks could have done differently in that fight, is that Blue Frog needs to position himself to counter-initiate after that hook. Uh-huh. He needs to follow up with his hook, at least isolate Acme, take down the Podge. Heck, commit this Static Storm on someone that matters. And keep your core alive. That's not happening. The supports aren't doing much to keep the Terrorblade alive.
Yeah, I agree. If the Terrorblade gets caught, you throw everybody's body to try and keep him alive.
Just ensure that he's not stunlocked so that he can get the Sunder off. Now it's too late. The problem is Kale has a BKB.
The other problem is Kale just hits like a truck, man.
Yeah. I would have advocated Blue Frog trying to isolate Legion Commander in the fights, but... if he doesn't do that, he's going to die. So that's no more an option.
Maybe if he had a blade mail of his own, it would have been better. But Hook, this time it splits the wickets.
Look, Kale could kill him. Let's do the math. I'm not sure the blade mail would be enough.
Acme is dropping his items now.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Just styling all over them.
Yeah.
Look at this. He's just bad-mouthing them in game.
Kind of hurts to be a Mirana and see all your arrows missing while all these hooks are connecting. As it's getting sidelined up. Kale walks up, pounds away on the tower. He can do this.
It's just melting at this point. Shondi's on the front line.
Feel the shackle shot isn't.
He got it!
But they've got the Wind Ranger! Make believe! What was that? There's no dream, excuse me. The duel is there. They managed to bring down the Sand King. One hit brings down the Disruptor. Kiko's trying to make a run for it. Kale running him down. The hook is there once more. Abs will bring down the Terrorblade. The tier 3 on the scene. Dream buys back. Kiko has buyback. But he's given up at this point. The Epicenter being channeled. The arrow will miss. Blue Frog with the hook shot. They're trying to find a response here. Blue Frog caught in the cogs. The power shot will
look
be
at make believe. He's just killing
and
himself.
A second shot. Look at that make believe trying to bring down the Spectre. But the dispersion just hurt him so much that he has to run right back to his fountain. And Shondi with the Aegis will respawn and move on to the barracks.
Make believe just basically beat himself up over there. He's sure he got the kill there, but that was an Aegis on Shondi. Who the hell cares?
And that's a base trip for make believe. They lose the Mirana, they lose the Aegis, but Kale with all that damage 214. He's going to move on to the tier 3 in the top lane.
Abs is flipping out on the stage, by the way.
Yeah.
I mean, all the possible cuss words that he learned in his high school have now been vomited out on the stage.
Words are being invented on stage right now. Shondi is going in. Blade mail, dispersion, hook from Magme. This is illegal. It should be. Kiko manages to bring down 11. The Sunder was nice, but Kale just pops his BKB and brings down the Tablade in return. Kiko has buybacks, but he's broken as an individual at this point. He's not even going to buyback and see what happens next.
Well, they're going once again. Akme's going to get caught out here.
They're going to get Akme. They committed the static storm. Make believe as a core should be killing the Pudge. Shondi by himself. He should consider turning around. Blue Frog with a hook shot. He's got Kale. Kale has the blade mail. Turns around, flings down Blue Frog. Shondi trying to get away. Dream with the Barrow Strike. Will manage to find him. Kale does manage to blink away.
He can't afford to die though. He's going to give up so much gold if he dies here. Arrow.
Abs is there.
It's going to sail past.
Abs is out of connect. No.
Kale will give up way too much money if he dies. They cannot afford to get free here. All they've got is one lane of barracks, and sure, they've got a mega massive lead, but they did end up losing a few kills in the last fight. And yeah, maybe you could see a few more throws like that turning the game back in their favor.
Yeah, a lot of throws like that.
Nah, who am I kidding? This is over. I'm sorry, man. I can't contain it. Wait. I just don't see how the hell Akramaks make a comeback here. Kale, look at that, man. He's even going to finish an Assault Cuirass, so Terrorblade is not going to be a concern for him anymore. Neither is the Mirana, is the Windranger for that matter. Dream's already been dead.
I really don't think anyone was much of a concern for Kale. But if there was any doubt in our heads, it's been cleared.
Yeah, even Spectre's building towards the heart with 3.5k gold sitting in the bank account. I think you pick up the Reaver and just go for the win.
Rolling through this garden called the Dire Jungle. Sees Kiko. Kiko making a run for it.
Hook. Not gonna find him though. They had vision.
Yeah.
Well, they actually didn't have vision. They just got scared. I feel so bad for Max. Look at his items. He has like three items at the moment. Boots, magic stick and a TP scroll.
Yeah. His starting items have transitioned into his late game items. He's a late start. Akme just hooking his own teammates now. He really misses the feeling of catching a hero with that hook.
Well, they've taken down the shrine as well now. Just getting a few bonus freebies on the sidelines here before thinking of going for the win. They could wait for the next Roshan if they want to. But they don't want to.
Akme just walking to tier 4.
What is he doing?
He's getting the shit out of them.
This is next level.
The haunt is there. They're going to run back a little bit more. Let's see who dies in the haunt. Max takes a whole lot of HP. The reflection flies. Kiko gets caught. Akme's caught the Terrorblade. Now there was the hook shot to try and keep the Terrorblade alive. A static storm, it's actually pretty decent. Kiko unfortunately caught in the duel. The shackle shot will ensure the kill onto the Spectre, but Kale is more than enough. He's managed to secure the kill on Kiko while Abs bought down Blue Frog somewhere on the side. They glimpse back Kale, but Kale just pops his BKB, blinks ahead, brings down that creep that's called Disruptor and make believe with the shackle shot, trying to find a kill in response. Akme is what they'd be hoping for here.
I mean, I think it's safe to say this game is over. Akramaks, despite the loss, they're going to go into the semi-finals, but it's a fairly humiliating way to go into the semis with your Dota squad. They're going to be up against a whole bunch of other megalomaniac teams. They're mega teams over there. And I just don't think they have what it takes to cut it. Yodhas, they've schooled them in their final game of Ucypher.